please contact Christian Answers for free information on numerous subjects, important subjects such as the biblical doctrine of the Godhead, the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Free newsletters are available on the heretical position held by many unbiblical cults, such as Jehovah's Witnesses and the Oneness Pentecostals who deny the Trinity. Free newsletters are available on strange groups such as the King James Onlyites. To receive your free information, please call 512-218-8022 or email us at cdebater@aol.com. Check out our websites, biblequery.org. This site answers 7,700 Bible questions. Historycart.com. This site reveals early church history and doctrine, proving Roman Catholicism is not historically or doctrinally viable. MuslimHope.com. This site is a classic refutation of Islam, a counterfeit religion created by Muhammad. Free newsletters are also available.
Hello, this is Larry Wessels with just a quick message to our viewers to check out our main YouTube channel, See Answers TV, which stands for Christian Answers Television, where we have all of our over 610 videos posted. By going there, you can see all of our videos organized by playlist, categorized by subjects. Once you scroll down past our Bible prophecy trailer at the top of the channel page, the playlist begin. You'll see our recent uploads playlist, followed by our most popular videos playlist, followed by our playlist on Jehovah's Witnesses, then Islam, the Muslim religion, then Roman Catholicism, Darwin's metaphysical evolution religion, Seventh-day Adventism, dealing with anti-Trinitarians and early church history. Our multiple playlist, which includes God-hating atheists, phony TV preachers and King James onlyists, dealing with UFOs, ghosts, spiritual warfare. Our radio shows with national Christian authors and our music vids, the Black Muslims, Louis Farrakhan, and the Nation of Islam, Mormonism, Hell, Lake of Fire, Unpopular Bible Doctrines, Antichrist, Cults, New Age, and World Religions. Charles Haddon Spurgeon, Jonathan Edwards, and Spanish videos, End Times, Supernatural Prophecies, and Tough Bible Questions, and our playlist dealing with predestination, Arminianism, and Calvinism. Our YouTube channel is built to help people learn the Bible and defend their Christian faith against false prophets that come against it from every side, Jude verses 3 and 4. At the time of this recording, our channel has already been blessed with over 6 million viewings and over 10,000 subscribers. And now for our main video presentation. Greetings and welcome once again to our program. I'm Larry Wessels, your host. I'm Director of Christian Answers of Austin, Texas, Christian Debater. And I want to thank you for being with us here today. Well, today we have a very special program, a type of program we're no strangers to. We're having a four-hour debate, of which this is show number four in that four-hour debate. I'm going to introduce our debaters and then talk about how the debate's structured, and things of that nature, and then we'll move right into it. It'll be a time debate, And I'll explain all that here in just a moment. Joining us in studio is Stephen Ritchie, who is an experienced author, apologist, pastor, evangelist, and debater who is currently teaching theology for Roe Bible College. He has written more than 30 books on apologetics, theology, prophecy, and Christian discipleship. Many of his free books, articles, and videos are posted at apostolicchristianfaith.com. Now, you can see that there on your screen at home, apostolicchristianfaith.com. Steve, thank you for being here with us. All right, now our other debater is my partner in this ministry, Christian Answers, of Austin, Texas, Christian debater. Steve is our director of research for our ministry. Steve is an apologist and author of the website BibleQuery.org, which answers over 8,500 questions on the Bible and provides information on a variety of topics, especially early Christian history. A second site, MuslimHope.com, shows Muslims the great hope they have when they leave Islam and follow the true Jesus Christ. I'd like to mention along these lines that Steve has written 4 books on Islam, which here's one, Letting Islam Destroy Itself in a Muslim's Mind, Reliability of the Bible and Christianity versus the Quran and Islam, Answering Muslim Objections to Christianity, and Christian Dialoguing with Muslims. You'll also find Steve in all our newsletters from Christian Answers. Okay, and Steve is also the author of a third website entitled HistoryCart.com, which covers early Christian church history, especially before 325 AD. By the way, you can see Steve's 18-part early church history series on YouTube by accessing our main YouTube channel, See Answers TV, and clicking on the playlist, Dealing with Anti-Trinitarians, UPC, and Early Church History. All right, with that introduction, I would now like to mention how this debate's going to work. We're going to begin show one with the first affirmative proposition, which will be by Stephen Ritchie. And I'll name that in just a minute. Then second hour of this debate will begin with the first affirmative proposition by Steve Morrison. And then the third, once again, will be by Stephen Ritchie with his second affirmative proposition. And then the fourth hour of this debate will then begin with Steve Morrison giving his second affirmative proposition. And we'll go from there. Now we have Hedges' rules of debate, which will apply here. And here's just a copy of each debater has that. But basically, the long and the short of it is, we're supposed to conduct a ethical debate here. No, you know, mean and nasty comments. Nothing out of order. It's just kind of a set of rules to have a nice, clean debate, you might say. All right. Now, what we're going to do is let me explain how this is going to work. Each hour of this debate is going to be set up in the following way, and you can see that here there on your screen. The affirmative speaker opens for 5 minutes. Then there's a negative to that first 5 minute opening affirmative by the other debater for 5 minutes. Then it goes back and forth 5 minutes each several times, about 4 times I would say, and then we have a 7 minute interactive discussion between the two debaters where they can interact with each other in an actual discussion, and they can interrupt each other as they go. And then to finish off the hour of debate, we have a 5 minute closing affirmative and then another 5 minute closing negative. That'll conclude that debate. Then we'll move on to the next one in another episode in this series. All right, with that said, the general biblical topic here of this debate is, what is the true biblical nature of God? The Trinity or the oneness Pentecostal God?
Well, we're beginning show number four now in our four-hour debate on the doctrine of the Trinity versus the oneness, Pentecostal doctrine of God, showing the distinctions and debating on that issue. We'll begin with Steve Morrison, who's affirming the Trinity. All right, with that, Steve will begin this hour of the debate with his five-minute opening affirmative. Go ahead, Steve.
Okay. First of all, I don't see this as a debate about how God has to be or what God can or cannot do. God is almighty, and all that we are doing here is we are trying to understand how God has chosen to reveal himself to us. And while I don't claim to know everything about God and God and his nature, I do think that as Christians we are responsible to understand to the limit of what God has revealed. The first diagram here, Larry read the proposition, which kind of succinctly describes the Trinity. Sometimes you can see the Trinity clearly by what it is not. And the first diagram here shows some common types of heresies that are with that. All right, the Trinity says one God. Now, on the bottom, if you deny that part of the Trinity, then you're into polytheism. And some of the early Gnostics were polytheists, and some of the early Gnostics you weren't really related to the Bible at all. Mormons, they don't claim to be polytheists generally, but when you ask them, do you believe there are many gods and you could become a god someday, they'll say yes. All right. And then in the Trinity, if you deny that they're co-equal or they're inseparable, then you get into a variety of things to where you say that the Son and or the Spirit are a lesser substance or a different substance. The Ebionites said that Jesus was God, but in title only. Okay, so they didn't really believe he had a divine nature. The Arians believed he was a different substance than God the Father, and then Semi-Arians said he was a similar substance, but that's still not the same substance. Jehovah's Witnesses, I used to say they were Arians. Many people say they are. Jehovah's Witness elder successfully convinced me, though, that they are not Arians. They are their own group, which I believe is true, but they do share that similarity in that you have Almighty God and God. The Way, I don't know how popular it is, Reverend Moon was said weird things where he denies the Trinity. There's a group called Socinians, and there are other people that say things. Now, if you deny that they're distinct, you actually have a couple of different things. You have what's called Sabellians, which is a type of oneness. There are Patripassians, they're called that the Father, you could say, died on the cross. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. And they go back to, from what we see, from the time of Tertullian, or Stephen Ritchie brought up, maybe even the time of Justin Martyr, you know, 50 years or so earlier. You have adoptionists that say that Jesus was a man, he was only a man, but he was a sinless man, and the Spirit of Christ came upon him, like either at baptism or incarnation. And then maybe or maybe not, he left on the cross. So they deny the distinctness in a different way. Then you have dynamic modalists that say the Father became the Son, like the Father was no longer there almost, and then the Son became the Spirit. And then you have, you know, other oneness groups too. So three things about the Trinity. Here are the consequences that happen when people deny those things. Okay, so one way of talking about the Trinity is kind of 6 to 8 doctrines, depending on how you count. Only one being is true God. If you don't believe that, then you don't believe the Trinity. And Stephen Ritchie, I will skip most of these verses because I think that Stephen Ritchie would affirm all of this. There is a certain threeness about God that's shown in Scripture, as well as a oneness. And, you know, if you think about Jesus' baptism, the Father speaking to the Son at the Transfiguration, and all these other verses show something about God or the Father and the Son or Jesus and the Spirit or the Holy Spirit. And you have to say, is the work on the cross, is it a work of man or is it a work of God? And the answer is yes. It is a work of man, the man Christ Jesus, who died for us and was our one and only mediator. And it is also the work of God. We are saved by God. We're not saved by a mere man. Okay. The Father, Son, Holy Spirit, they're the same in nature. They're the same in honor. Jesus said, if you honor the Son, you know, as you honor the Father who sent him, they're the same in glory. okay, there's no difference here. We don't need to worry about, well, do I have 33% of my prayers to one and the others or the others? But they are distinct persons who interact with each other. And I use the word persons. That is just a human construct to understand it. If you use the word manifestation or I guess even extension, that's okay too. But they do have different roles. The Father sends the Son. The Son didn't send the Father. The Jesus asked the Father to send the Holy Spirit. It wasn't the other way around. So they indwell each other. Okay.
All right. Thank you, Steve. We will now give 5 minutes to Stephen Ritchie for a five-minute rebuttal. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Larry. Mr. Morrison's first proposition states that the God in the Bible and the early Christians is in Trinity, one inseparable God in three eternally distinct persons indwelling each other. Mr. Morrison, how could God, who is a spirit, indwell the Holy Spirit? There's no verse in the scriptures that says that the Father indwells the Holy Spirit. I challenge him to find a single verse that says the Father indwells the Holy Spirit. He said all three eternally distinct persons indwell each other. Well, we know God indwelt the Son. God was in Christ Jesus reconciling the world to himself. But we never find God in the Holy Spirit. Again, we find this post-incarnational relationship between the Father and the Son. God can modally operate as one single monarch, monarchianism, one single king, as one single heavenly Father. He can operate as the Father. He can send his own spirit. He can send his own word like a man can send an email. Of course, much more transcendent matter than that. But God can manifest himself. The Holy Spirit is the manifestation of the Spirit of the Father. God can send his spirit down because man can't send his spirit around because we're finite creatures. Even angels are creatures. Even Satan will be bound in the bottomless pit for 1,000 years. So we know there's only one God who is omnipresent. Jesus is the omnipresent spirit because he's that God who became a human spirit. So we don't have a trinity of three divine persons. We have one divine person, one individual, who will always be our heavenly Father. Have we not one Father? Has not one God created us? Malachi 2:10. Isaiah 64:8 says, you are our Father. We are the clay. You are our potter. We are all the work of your hands. So God created all things alone and by himself, by his invisible hands. The Son has been appointed to rule over the works of God the Father's hands. Psalms 8:5 and 6. Hebrews 2:7 cites that very passage, proving that Jesus is the one who is appointed to rule over the works of the Father's hands. So Mr. Morrison is saying that each alleged divine person indwells each other. So I challenge him to cite a single verse where the Father indwells the Holy Spirit. We find Jesus saying in John 14:10, and I quote, the Father who dwells in me, he does the works. We find in 2 Corinthians 15:9 that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, but we never find a single verse which says that the Father was ever in or indwelling the Holy Spirit. Nor do we find Jesus ever praying to the Father. He always prayed to the Father, never to the Holy Spirit, because there's only one true God, the Father, John 17:3. And so many of these early so-called Trinitarians, quoted by my opponent, were really Arians. We find in the New Advent Catholic Encyclopedia under Arianism, Arianism from an early date denied Christ's co-equal deity and co-eternal existence. These men were named semi-Arians. While they affirmed that the Word of God is everlasting, they imagine him as having become the Son to create the world and to redeem mankind. In other words, the Son did not always exist as the Son, but he became the Son in order to create the world and redeem mankind. Five, and I'm quoting from the Catholic Encyclopedia, five Ante-Nicene fathers are especially quoted: Athenagoras, Tatian, Theophilus of Antioch, Hippolytus, and Novatian. And then Cardinal Newman goes on to add Tertullian and Methodius, whose language appears to involve a peculiar notion of sonship, as though he did not come into being or were not perfect until the dawn of creation. And then it says, to these may be added Tertullian and Methodius. Cardinal Newman held that their view, which is found clearly in Tertullian, of the Son existing after the Word, is connected with the antecedent with Arianism. So these so-called Trinitarians that my opponent is bringing up were really semi-Arians, and they were the ones who were contending against the modalistic monarchians, who were in the majority of the believers during the late 2nd century and early 3rd century, according to Tertullian and Hippolytus themselves. God bless.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Ritchie. We will now go to Mr. Morrison, who will give us his second affirmative proposition. You have 5 minutes, sir.
Okay. A little bit of time to talk about what he said and also the early church fathers and another thing. First of all, for the Holy Spirit, in John 14:23, so Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. My Father and I will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. And Jesus had just said prior to this that the Holy Spirit will dwell inside us. And so if the Holy Spirit is inside us, and through that Christ is inside us, and through that the Father is inside us, then that shows, an indwelling by the three in us. And the Bible doesn't say as much about the Holy Spirit. But anyway, the other thing related to Arians is you don't always go by what the Catholic Encyclopedia says, because I have many early church writers, including some of those he mentioned, that believe that the Son was, the Word was distinct from the Father at creation, okay? And so, not just the incarnation, but before then. Tatian, you mentioned, you've got to be careful with Tatian, because Tatian translated the Diatessaron, which is a paraphrase, actually it's not a paraphrase, it's putting together the four Gospels, and it's very much like the scriptures we have today, just put together. However, later he became a heretic. He was an Encratite Gnostic heretic. But anyway, the others, some of them did believe that the Son was begotten before the ages in time. Tertullian and Justin Martyr are two like that. But the others believe that the Son was begotten before the beginning of time, which would make them decidedly non-Arian. And you don't see anything with that. Now, the other thing I'd like to discuss is a little bit about a oneness. And there's actually not one oneness. There are actually at least four different onenesses. Maybe Stephen could show me there might be a five. I don't know. But at least there's four that I see. The first one says that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, they were all born, they all suffered, they all died, and they all rose. And this was the original oneness that Tertullian wrote against. And it was started by a guy named Sibelius. Okay, well, that didn't really last too much, because people thought, well, that's crazy that the Father died on the cross for our sins. Okay, but then there was another version that's by a guy named Novatian, and Hippolytus wrote against him, and he said that the sort of the same thing, but the Father was both begotten and unbegotten, and as the begotten, he died. So it's like he's renaming things, but basically the same thing. So I call these kind of strains of oneness, because the first two are pretty similar to each other, and the last two are similar to each other. There was one guy named Theodotus the Tanner of Byzantium, and he said that at Jesus' baptism, God adopted and indwelt a non-divine sinless man. The Father suffered, he says, but the Father left before Jesus died. So he gets around the fact of the Father dying on the cross by doing that. And I don't think that that's Stephen's view either. And then there was another guy, Callistus of Rome, who got some of his views from Sibelius and some of his views from Theodotus, and he said that the Son's flesh was raised to divinity, and it's a little unclear was that when was the flesh divinity. It was not really, we don't really specify where it was, but if you just say that the Son is a human man and he was indwelt by God or the Spirit, that sounds kind of like John the Baptist, and we certainly don't worship John the Baptist. We're not Mandeans who do. And anyway, Callistus, he was not Pope of Rome, because they didn't have popes till, no one was called Pope till Siricius in like 386 AD, but he was a bishop of Rome, and Hippolytus was against him, and Callistus, the bishop of Rome, excommunicated Sibelius. So at least they saw their views as quite different than each other. And a question for Stephen is, which of these four views do you hold, or do you have a fifth view? most objections to the Trinity, you could say that, you know, on earth, first of all, God in the Bible, sometimes it means God the Father. Sometimes it means when Thomas says to Jesus, my Lord and my God, he's looking at, you know, Jesus Christ, the incarnate Jesus Christ. And in one case in Acts, it means just the Holy Spirit. On earth, of course, Jesus suffered and died and did various things.
30 seconds.
But even in heaven, Jesus, it talks about the Father, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the God of our Lord Jesus Christ in the Bible. And so it shows that there's still a distinction of the manifestations even now. Okay, but the three are the same in love, essence, name, glory, titles, and honor. And this is what the early church believed, with one city going bad for 38 years. Okay.
All right. Stephen Ritchie is up.
Thank you. Ephesians 4:3-6 says again, there's only one Lord, one faith, one Spirit, one God and Father above all, through us all and in us all. There are different manifestations, I agree, but to say persons is adding to the divine revelation. God is one divine individual, one essence of being. In fact, the scriptures many times call God a single person. Genesis 17:17 says, then Abraham fell upon his face and laughed and said in his heart. The actual Hebrew word here is lev, which means heart or inner person. Genesis 27:41, Esau said in his heart, lev, heart or inner person. But Genesis 8:21 says, and Yahweh smelled a sweet aroma, and Yahweh said in his heart, his inner person. So the scriptures plainly state that God is a single person. The Hebrew word translated as heart clearly proves that God has a single heart like we do, but of course God's spirit transcends man's heart, man's spirit. So just as man has one heart or inner person, so God has one heart or inner person. Exodus 3:14 said, God said to Moses, I am who I am. He said, thus you shall say to the children, the sons of Israel, I am has sent me to you. Again, Isaiah 4:3-10, so that you may not believe me, understand that I am he. Jesus said, John 8:24, if you not believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. In context, John 8:27 states, they did not realize that he was speaking to them about the Father. When Jesus said, I am he was speaking about the deity of the Father. So to answer your question, Mr. Morrison, Sibelius was quoted by his opponents. You know, so often, even today, we like to misquote our opponents. We twist what they say to try to make them look bad. It's interesting that all of Sibelius's writings are now gone. He was very famous. He was very popular. In fact, Athanasius, during the beginning of the 4th century, said that Sibelius was so successful that there was hardly a church that preached the Son of God. And so they thought, you know, he wasn't preaching, that they were not preaching the Son. Again, Athanasius was misquoting. Of course they preached the Son, but they said that the Son is the Father who became a man. And so Noetus as well. I look at this. None of these writings of Practice Noetus have survived. Just like I would want to take the writings of the Watchtower Bible Tract Society, I wouldn't want to take them and copy them and distribute them out. So it's easy to see how the Catholic Church, once the Trinitarian doctrine was fully entrenched, later on Mariology was shortly to come after that. Actually, this happened at the same time. The 5th century is when Mariology began, and that's when the words three co-equal and co-eternal persons began to be written. It's not the Athanasian creed exactly. They call it the Athanasian creed, but it was never developed by Athanasius. So I believe no modern day oneness Pentecostals, we do not believe that any of this idea of Jesus was sometimes, or the Father was sometimes the Father, the Son was sometimes the Son, the Holy Spirit was, no, God the Father is always the Father. He can't change. Malachi 3:6 says, I am Yahweh, I change not. So the only true God, the Father, never changed. While he also became a man by extending his own holy arm. Jesus is the arm of Yahweh revealed when God became a man. So anthropomorphically, God clearly shows his oneness when he says that Jesus is the arm of Yahweh, God the Father's arm revealed. It doesn't say a son of God's arm was revealed. It says God, Yahweh's arm was revealed. In Christian history, it's very deep. You have to look and dig into Christian history. If you look at early Christian historians and documents, for instance, here's a good quote from a Protestant scholar by the name of Harold Brown. On page 5 of his book, entitled Heresy and Orthodoxy in the History of the Church, and I quote, "It is impossible to document what we now call Trinitarian Orthodoxy in the first 2 centuries of Christianity." It's impossible to document this orthodoxy of the Trinity in the first 2 centuries. Why did a scholarly Trinitarian scholar say this, historian? Because there was no true Trinitarian doctrine developed yet. It wasn't fully developed until the so-called Athanasian Creed, which was either the late 5th century or the early 6th century when it was fully developed. So nobody, even Athanasius, never actually used three co-equal, co-eternal persons. He had the concept, I will admit, of a Trinity idea, but it wasn't fully developed. God bless.
All right. Steve Morrison, you're up.
Okay. First of all, as the quote that says that the world believed in Sabellianism or Trinitarianism, I think it wasn't Athanasius. I think you meant to say Tertullian.
No,
Athanasius.
I can
also
back that up. I got it.
Okay, then. Yet Irenaeus, who wrote 182 to 188 AD, long before either one of them, said that the church dispersed throughout the whole world, even to the ends of the earth, has received from the apostles and their disciples this faith. And then it keeps on going, and it sounds sort of, but not like the Nicene Creed. She believes in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, the sea, and all that are in them. And in one Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who became incarnate, knows, for our salvation. So he was Son of God, became. And the Holy Spirit, who proclaimed the prophets of the dispensations of God. And so he goes on and says, say what he believes. And so Irenaeus says everyone believed the same thing. Now Caius, who lived 190 to 217 AD, he said that basically everyone believed the same until the times of Victor, who was Bishop of Rome. And after Victor died, then he said that things were falsified. Truth was falsified under Zephyrinus, who was kind of like maybe, I don't want to say stooge, but maybe under Callistus. And then Callistus, who became pope after that. And then once the Decian persecution came before 250 AD, then that kind of all died out. So we don't have them anymore. But anyway, what I would call the simplest oneness, you know, Father, Holy Spirit, died on the cross, end of story, that was what they first believed. Stephen Ritchie has said that oneness today don't believe that. I'm sad to report that that's not quite true. I know Stephen Ritchie does not believe that himself, but I heard on a radio show a oneness pastor saying, "I refuse to worship of God who would send his boy to die on the cross instead of coming himself." Okay, and that now how standard his views are, and he said other stuff too, and he was definitely Sabellian. Now how standard his views are within oneness, I don't know, but at least there is some of that today. But Stephen's view is not that, is there three manifestations. And anyway, in what we see, both from what Novatian, Hippolytus, and Caius, and everyone wrote about, admittedly we don't have the writings, we don't see this developed view. We either see something that's Trinitarian, but we don't see something that says there are three manifestations. But the manifestations didn't come about. Now, as far as what you said about they didn't believe in co-equal because you claimed that they were kind of Arians, let's go look here. We show that they're distinct, from creation, but they show a co-equality, except they would say that that it was the Son that was begotten and not the Father. So I would contend the early church was not Arians. You had a few people who were oneness in a Sabellian way, or they were oneness in another way. That sounds like Stephen Ritchie would not accept those ways either, the weird adoptionist thing or something like that. And so you don't see any early people in the time of early Christianity that believed exactly like Stephen says oneness believed today. They're not there. You know, he would reject the Father dying on the cross. well, then he would reject, you know, many of the, quote, early oneness, and so there wasn't anybody who really believed like he did back then, okay? And I would say that the early Christians believed pretty much like I do in the Trinity, and I would say they weren't perfect, and some of them were mistaken on some points, but they believed in a distinction between the Father and the Son. They believed in the eternality of the Son, just like Hebrews 1:2 says, that all things were created through the Son, and yet they believed in a co-equalness of all of them.
All right, Mr. Ritchie, it's your turn.
Okay. Roman Catholic cardinal and historian John Henry Newman wrote in his book, Arians of the Fourth Century Under Sabellianism, and I quote from page number 118 of his book, he writes of his doctrine, meaning Sabellius, became so popular among the clergy already prepared for it that in a short time, to use the words of Athanasius, the early 4th century Christian writer, the Son of God was scarcely preached in the churches. So it was Athanasius who said this. So Monarchian or Sabellian views were very popular in the mid-3rd century, late 3rd century, even the very beginning or in the time of Athanasius and around the Council of Nicaea. Tertullian himself, who first utilized the word Trinity with the words three persons, wrote in Against Practice Chapter 3 that the modalistic monarchians, and I quote, who always constitute the majority of believers, rejected Tertullian's emerging Trinitarian-type view. Pelican, historian, church historian, Jaroslav Pelican, also cited Against Practice Chapter 3, that Tertullian's statement Against Practice Chapter 3 proves, and this is the words of Pelican, that the modalistic monarchians were, and I'm quoting from Pelican, the simple people who are always the majority of the faithful. Notice, always. So according to Tertullian, the majority of the faithful Christians, and Tertullian lived in the very late part of the second century into the early third, and at that time of Christianity, they, the monarchians, were always among the majority of the Christians. And so these early Christian writers, many times quoted by scholars like James White, in debates trying to prove that Jesus is God, they were actually modalists that they were quoting. They didn't believe Jesus is, some other God. They believed that Jesus is God becoming a man. We find, let me see, where's this? So many things here. I'm going to just move on. Let me go ahead and just say this. Now let's just move on. Back in time. In Hermas, Parable 5:6, Hermas wrote, the pre-existent Holy Spirit, which created all things, did God make to dwell in a body of flesh chosen by himself. Hermas declared that the Holy Spirit of God incarnated himself in the body of Jesus. Hence, Hermas clearly believed that the deed of Jesus is the Holy Spirit, just like I said before. In Hermas, Similitude 9:1, and I quote, the angel of repentance said to me, I want to show you what the Holy Spirit, which spoke with you in the form of the church, showed you, for that Spirit is the Son of God. So the Holy Spirit is the Spirit that became the Son of God. So these early Christians did not believe in the Trinity. They believed the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of the Son of God. You don't have three persons, you've got two persons. You got one divine person, the Father, who's also holy, the Holy Spirit, and that Spirit became the Son of God. Also, in 2 Clement 14, 3 and 4, it states that the Holy Spirit is the Spirit which is Christ. And I quote, guard the flesh that you may partake of the Holy Spirit. Now, if we say that the Spirit is Christ, then verily he who has dishonored the flesh has dishonored the church. Such a one, therefore, shall not partake of the Spirit which is Christ. So the Holy Spirit is Christ, according to Clement. And this is of a very early time. Some dispute whether this is the Clement of Rome, but there's a lot of evidence to show this was probably the Roman bishop of the first century who personally knew the apostles. And so this proves that the early Christians in Rome believed in modalism. They believed that the Spirit of God became the child born and son given via incarnation and not the later Trinitarian doctrine. Jaroslav Pelican, a Trinitarian historian, wrote, that many of the passages in ancient Christian writers sound like modalistic monarchianism. Then in the same paragraph on page 177, Pelican cited Ignatius and Melito to show that their writings sounded like modalism. And so we find that modalism was a very prominent doctrine. Methides, a disciple, direct disciple of the apostles, said in his epistle to Diognetus, chapter 9, having now revealed the Savior who is able to save, he desired to lead us to trust in his kindness, to esteem him our nourisher, our father, teacher, counsel, healer, and wisdom. So Methides identified Jesus the Savior as the Father. Have we not one Father?
Thank you, Mr. Ritchie. Okay, Steve Morrison, you now have 5 minutes to continue to affirm your affirmative.
Okay, all right. Going back to what I said before, I'm a little surprised that Harold Brown that Catholic theologian would say that, because we have no evidence of any people following Sibelius outside of Rome for that time. The early Christians, they show distinction. For example, Evarestus in 169 AD, he refers to glorifying the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Justin Martyr says, we worship and adore the Father, Son, and prophetic Spirit. Theophilus of Antioch, and he was actually the first to use the word Trinity that we know of. Tertullian was the first to use it in Latin, Trinitas. But Theophilus would say, in like manner also, the 3 days which are before the luminaries, that is, sun, moon, and stars, are types of the Trinity, or triad in Greek, of God, his word, and his wisdom. And that's Theophilus to Autolycus, book 2, 15, page 101. Okay, we already talked about Irenaeus. Clement of Alexandria, who was kind of contemporary with Tertullian, but maybe wrote a little bit before him, we're not sure. He used the word Trinity. So he talks about the first things, the second things, and the third. And I mean, nothing else than the Holy Trinity be meant. For the third is the Holy Spirit, and the second is the Son, by whom all things were made according to the will of the Father. Okay, so these guys definitely believed in a distinction, but none of them believed in a separate God. None of them believed in a lesser God. So we don't have anything about that. Athanasius, he mentioned the Sabellians, I think, sort of in passing, because his main emphasis was on the Arians. And the Arians, soon after the Council of Nicaea, sort of took over the church because the emperor ordered the banishment of the Orthodox bishops and ordered the Arians to become the bishops of the church. But then later on, the Christians, the Arian bishops were left and the Christians went back. So it's really Arianism that Athanasius was against, though he did mention Sabellianism what was wrong also. I guess relying on Catholic historians and theologians, I would rely on the writings of the early Christians themselves. And they show a distinctness, they show a oneness also. Just to give an example, the letter of Barnabas on Genesis 1:27, where it says, God says, let us make man in our image. For the scripture says concerning us, while he speaks to the Son, let us make man after our image and after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the beasts of the earth and over the fowls of heaven. Okay, I mean, that sounds like pre-existence of the Son right there. The other things, you mentioned First Clement or Second Clement?
Second Clement.
Second Clement probably was not written by the same person who wrote First Clement. Second Clement doesn't say it was by Clement, it's just people kind of assigned it to Clement. So we don't know so much about that. But they affirmed a Father and a Son, and the idea that they can indwell each other, I think, settles the fact. And in a sense, Jesus is the Father of our salvation. In the sense, Jesus is also indwelt by the Father. But that doesn't mean that there's no Father except the one who walked on earth. As you yourself said, Steve Ritchie, you believe that Jesus is a manifestation of God, which we agree on. And so we do have the three there. But there's this idea of saying that there are three manifestations, but they're not persons. We don't, see that in Sibelius, Noetus, or anything that they said about that. We see adoptionist stuff. We see a what I'd call a simple oneness. To say the Father died on the cross, and they're not really the same here. We have a Papias of Hierapolis, and Papias was a disciple of John the Apostle. He said the presbyters and disciples, just a second here, and that moreover they ascend through the Spirit to the okay. They ascend to the Spirit, the Son, and to the Son to the Father, and in due time the Son will yield up his work to the Father, even as is said by his apostle, for he must reign till he has put all enemies under his feet. We already talked about Aristides. Melito of Sardis, I believe you mentioned him. He was incorporeal. He formed for a body after his fashion. Appearing as a sheep, he still remained a shepherd. He esteemed a servant, yet not renouncing sonship. All right, and so going on.
Time's up.
Okay.
All right, we will now have 5-minute rebuttal by Mr. Ritchie.
Well, first of all, the scripture is what we go with. I mean, we go to church history, we could just go on and on forever, but I'm going to cover a few things on church history. We want to get back to the scripture. But we do need to look at what Trinitarian historians have said as well, which I love to quote from Trinitarian historians because they're admitting the things that we all know, that we oneness believers know. So Roman Catholic historian John Henry Newman wrote in his book, Arians of the Fourth Century Under Sibellianism, page 129, and I quote, in the time of Dionysius of Alexandria, 248 to 264, the majority of Christians were patripassian, meaning father suffers or Sibellian, but in the time of Alexander, 310 through 326, during the time of Nicaea, the Sibellians advocated an emanative theology. So even Trinitarian historians admit that the Sibellians were still quite prominent during the time of the Council of Nicaea. We find that Jaroslav Pelikan wrote in the Emergence of Catholic Tradition, page 1, page 207, that Marcellus of Ancyra, and I quote, proved an embarrassment to Nicaean Orthodoxy because he and other Sibellian monarchians were among the signers of the Nicene Creed in 325 AD. Then Pelikan wrote on page 203 of the same book, yet it was to the doctrine espoused by Alexander of Alexandria that the imperial palm was given by the emperor, and it was in this light of this doctrine that the Creed of Nicaea was to be interpreted. The Encyclopedia Britannica states that Alexander, the Bishop of Alexandria, from 313 to 328, during the time of Nicaea, whose views appeared to tend towards Sibellianism. Under Arianism, the New Advent Catholic Encyclopedia states in 319 AD, Epiphanius accused the Patriarch of Alexander of teaching that the Son was identical to the Father. So according to those who lived during this time period, Alexander was teaching that the Son is identical to the Father. Hence, it is clear that the Molinists signed the original Nicene Creed because it was in harmony with Alexander's teachings on Sibellian-type theology. So it's very interesting when you look at church history and you go deep into it. I don't really want to stay so much on church history, though I like to go to Scripture. I'm going to go back to, like, say, 1 Samuel 2:35. Yahweh God said, I will raise up for myself a faithful priest who shall do according to what is in my heart and my soul. Now, it's interesting. The Greek word nephesh literally means a soul or inner person. You know, we don't find person throughout the Hebrew scriptures nor in the Greek scripture, but to the ancients, a soul is a person. It's the same thing as our modern day vernacular as a person. Mm-hmm. So really what God's saying, by him saying my heart and my soul, he's saying my heart and my inner person. Psalm 11:5 says, Yahweh tests the righteous and the wicked, and his soul or his person hates him that loves violence. Proverbs 6:16 says, these six things Yahweh hates, seven are an abomination to his soul or his person. Isaiah 1:14 says, your new moons and scheduled feasts, my soul or my person hates. Jeremiah 6:8 says, be warned, O Jerusalem, lest my soul or my person be alienated from you. Jeremiah 15:1, even though Moses and Samuel were to stand before me, my soul or my person would not be with this people. Amos 6:8, the Lord Yahweh has sworn by his own soul or his own person. Now, I'm just quoting dozens of scriptures, I could keep going on, that show that God is one single sole person. I challenge my opponent to cite a single verse of scripture to show that God is three sole persons, three spirits in the plural, three mouths. For a person to be a person, you've got to have a mouth. A person has to be able to speak for himself. But if God is only one God, as one individual, one he, one I, one me, and we find the mouth of the Lord, the face of the Lord, the nose of God, the hand of God, the right hand of God, over and over throughout the scripture, we don't find any proof of this mysterious Trinity concept.
30 seconds.
So, but when we see, when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son who was born of a woman. The son didn't speak to us in the Hebrew scriptures. It says in Hebrews 1 and 2, God spoke in time past to the Israelite ancestors by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by his son. So the son did not actually speak, as far as we know, until these last days, according to New Testament inspired scripture.
Time's up. All right, we will now go to the 7-minute interactive phase of this debate. It's just open dialogue. Both people can ask any questions, respond, interact, however they want to go. So, gentlemen, begin. You got 7 minutes.
All right, if I can start. Early Christians and Sabellianism, you mentioned Alexander of Alexandria, who was the Bishop of Alexandria, a very important city. He says that on the third day after his death, Jesus rose again, bringing to us the knowledge of the Trinity. All nations of the human race were saved by Christ. Jesus was made like as to man, ascended to the height of heaven, and the Father raised him and made Jesus the judge of the peoples and king forever and ever. Sounds Trinitarian to me. Marcellus of Ancyra, he was after Nicaea, and as if he was an embarrassment to the church, that would mean that in general the church did not accept that. You said, where does God say that, you know, show a plurality? You know, this is my soul. Again, Genesis 1:26, it says, let us make man in our image. Isaiah 6:8, who will go for us? So I'm not denying that it shows a singularity from God. I'm saying that the scripture shows a plurality and a singularity. But I want to ask you, the Creed of Nicaea, would you agree with that or disagree with that creed?
I agree with the original Nicene Creed 325. I don't quite agree with the changes made to the Constantinopolitan Creed around 381 AD. I do agree, because I do believe the modalists did agree with that.
Okay.
The semi-Trinitarians at the time, also such as Athanasius, agreed. Of course, the Arians were the only ones that couldn't, because they totally denied their view that Jesus is not divine, the same substance.
So you agree with the original Nicaea, but not necessarily later stuff.
Right.
Okay.
Correct.
How about Ephesus, which was against Nestorius, and Chalcedon, which was against the Monophysites?
From 381 AD onward, that's when the church started, you know, murdering their opponents under Damasus, for instance. So that was the one that first started, you know, that's when the Catholic Church really started getting formulated, I believe, where they started using the imperial authority to begin killing people, and that's where Mariology started developing, obviously in the very 5th century, 400s. So I don't give them any credence as being true Christians whatsoever by then, as far as the state church. But let me go to the let us make man real quick. I like to stick with scripture as much as possible.
Okay.
You know, there's two different views held by oneness Christians. One is that, you know, God always speaks to his heavenly court, and I kind of think both ideas might be correct. Even some prominent Trinitarian scholars admit that Genesis 1:26 does not prove a plurality of divine persons. Gordon Wenham wrote in his Word Biblical Commentary on Genesis, Christians have traditionally seen Genesis 1:26 as adumbrating the Trinity. It is now universally admitted that this was not what the plural meant to the original author. The NIV Study Bible admits in Genesis 1:26 that it describes God speaking to the members of his heavenly court. So, you know, God could have said, let us make man, just like, you know, a human king would say, why don't we do this? Let us, you know, Adolf Hitler could say, let us, you know, let's invade Poland or whatever. You know, they include, God always included his angels. God doesn't do anything without his prophets, and God doesn't do anything without his angelic advisors as well. But it's also possible to believe that, in a sense, God prophetically said, let us make man to the Son, just like he prophetically said, to his son, "You are my son, this day have I begotten you," as if the son already existed. "You are my son this day." Well, that's a prophetic reference of Jesus being actually born this day. So "let us make man" could be also a prophetic reference to the son, because Jesus is also, before he became a man, he is that God. He is that Father. So, you know, God was professing through the prophetic word that the son would also be called the creator. That's also a possibility in the realm of possibility.
But against the first one, I don't think that we were made really at all by angels. You know, I think God made Adam and Eve, and of course he made us different than the animals. And so I don't really, I know other Trinitarians do hold to what's called the royal we view. I don't myself. But the early Christians, Letter Barnabas, Justin Martyr, Irenaeus, Tertullian, they all accepted that was the Father and the Son. And as far as it being prophetic, that view, it's like, well, then it's kind of non-falsifiable if you just say everything's prophetic, because it's like, why would he be having a discussion? Don't you believe that the Word was there in the beginning? Could he have been talking to the Word?
Well, the Word doesn't mean a person. The Word is just the express thought of God the Father.
But
the beginning was the Word. It doesn't say the Word was a person. There's no scripture anywhere in the Old Testament or New Testament that says, or the Greek word logos means a person.
Well, it means Jesus Christ, and Christians are pretty unanimous about in early Christians. So do you think that the impersonal logos became the manifestation of God, or you think it's just like kind of extraneous material in John 1 before talking about Christ?
Well,
how does that relate?
In a sense, God, before the world was even created, God already prophetically knew what he was going to do. Titus 1:2 says the hope of eternal life was already promised before the world began, before the ages began.
That's prophetic.
Before creation, right. So Jesus was already the lamb slain for the creation of the world. So in a sense, God's elect and Jesus were already chosen. They're already called. And God already spoke, Romans 4:17, God calls the things which be not as though they already were. So in a sense, God spoke of the Son as if he already was, before he actually became the Son. They pierced my hands and my feet as if it already happened.
But if the Word was already with God, as well as God, wouldn't it, and if the Word is talking about Jesus in John 1, then wouldn't it make sense that, you know, if the Word is Jesus, you know, it seems like you either got to say that the Word is personal, Jesus, or the Word is impersonal, which I think is what you said, or the Word is just a separate thing just kind of sitting out there in limbo. But if John 1 refers to Jesus, it says all things were made through him. Of course, Hebrews 1:2 says all things were made through the Son. So to me, John 1:1 is all about the Word and Jesus.
Well, Jesus said, "The words that I speak unto you are spirit and life." God is light, God is love, God is the Word. It's the same basic meaning. It's part of who God is. God is the Word. God's word is living, Hebrews 4:12. I want to get to this, though. The Father gave Jesus a name above all names, and you stated that there's a rank among the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Mr. Morrison, how could the Son, I can't even get to it.
Sorry. Well, you still got some time here in a minute. Okay, we're now into the last closing statements. Since we're in Steve's affirmative, he begins with 5 minutes on his closing statement, affirmative, and then you'll get your... You'll get the final say, Stephen,
okay.
the five-minute closing for you. Okay, Steve, you're up.
All right, well maybe one key to understanding about the Trinity is, what do you do with this word in John 1:1? In John 1:14, it says, "And the Word," specifically Word here, "became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory is of the only begotten of the Father." And so this Word became flesh at the incarnation, and so this Word is the Son of Man, the second person of the Trinity. But to summarize, and they have a different rank, doesn't mean that one is less than the other in any way. It just means that the Son was sent by the Father, and the Holy Spirit, the Son asked the Father to send the Holy Spirit. But to summarize about the Trinity, it's one God. They are inseparable. But they are three. Stephen liked to use the word manifestations. I want to use the word persons, but we're kind of close here. They are three, but they are not separate, and there is an indwelling involved with them. And that pretty much will cover everything in every scripture if you understand those things. And it's not so much that I guess deny the truths or the scripture that Stephen says, but it's just Stephen denies the additional stuff, or some he denies and some maybe he kind of, I think, sort of agrees with, though we don't agree completely. As far as the early Christians, like Stephen, I think, would say, Scripture is inerrant, and Scripture is our primary authority. The early Christians and early church are not. They are fallible people. I assume you agree with that. But they generally were pretty good, and we can learn from our older brothers, so to speak, with the caveat that we only look at them as echoes of the truth, and we look at as God's word as the primary truth. And they taught a distinctness of the Father, Son, and Spirit. They did not teach a separateness. I do not see them teaching a lesser than. There were Dionysius of Alexandria and Dionysius of Rome. They did write against Sabellians. You don't hear too much about Sabellians as a historical thing until after that. And then, of course, Arianism came full bore about 300 AD, and we both agree that Arianism is wrong. But the three manifestations, there is a certain threeness about Scripture. We agree on that. And, now we need to see if that's eternal or not. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, moved over the waters. I would say that was a manifestation. That was the third manifestation, or second, if you say 1 + 2 manifestations that moved over the waters. And so there's a certain threeness about God as well as a oneness about God.
Mr. Ritchie will now have 5 minutes to make his closing statement. Go ahead.
Well, I cited quite a few scriptures, I believe a couple dozen scriptures, that say that God is one individual, God is one soul, one person. I've never heard Mr. Morrison cite a single verse that actually says God is three souls, three persons, three spirits as three divine persons. God is one individual. He's always been one God. He is always of the unchangeable God. That's what I like about Malachi 3:6. Yahweh, God as God, is unchangeable. I am Yahweh, I change not. So God could not have left heaven, or a divine person leave heaven, leave his position, his omnipresence, his omnipotence, his omniscience, and cease being God for a while to come to save us. God, be an omnipresent God, can never lose any of his divine attributes. If God was like a man, if God was like an angel, it would be impossible for the incarnation to take place, because finite man and created angelic creatures cannot be in two places at once. But God can be the God in the heavens who never changes, yet simultaneously become a human being by the power of the Holy Spirit and the Word. But I do agree a certain amount of plurality to God, but not persons. That's my problem with Trinitarianism. Mm-hmm. God is his word. The word is God. God is the word. God is light. God is love. God has unchangeable attributes that are him, who he is. And so God's word was made flesh. The actual word, when you think about it, I kind of want to cover this a little bit. The word really is the Greek word logos. It means the express thought of a person. It doesn't mean a person in and of itself. Jesus said in Matthew 28:15, the words ho logos autos appear in the singular masculine form, so we would normally think that it refers to a person, but the context proves that a person is not in view. Therefore, the translators wrote story and not a person. Even though the Greek word logos appears, the translators wrote story. So you got to look at the context, Matthew 28:15. And they took the money and did as they had been instructed. And this story, hotos logos, was widely spread among the Jews of that day. We can clearly see that the words hotos logos appears in a singular masculine form, just as we see hotos is linked to logos in John 1:1-2 in the singular masculine form. Since John 1:2 uses the same Greek word hotos in a singular masculine form and not totos, a thing, we know that we must look at the context to show if a person is in view or not. John 1:2 appears as autos en arche prostantheon, But the word autos is not linked to a person within the context of John 1, 1 through 3, but to the word logos, as in Matthew 28, 15. Therefore, the word, just as in Matthew 28, 15, therefore the word autos should normally be translated as this rather than a he within the context of that passage. Moving on, I brought up, scriptures. God is one person, again and again, one soul. It's the same thing as our English word person. I meant to bring up Galatians 3:20. Greek scholars call God is one person. They actually translate, Greek scholar, Trinitarian scholar by the name of Brapter, translates Galatians 3:20 as God is one person. We find God is one individual according to Westward Pictures of the Greek New Testament. The Amplified Bible translates Galatians 3:20, God is one person. Whenever God spoke anthropomorphically, he spoke of himself as one single person. One right hand, one face, Exodus 33:20. The mouth of God, Numbers 12:8. The breath of God, Psalm 33:6. The eyes of God, the nose of God, Exodus 15:8. The heart of God, Hosea 11:8, and so forth. So we see clearly that God is one individual being. The problem with Arians, Socinians, Trinitarians, they start seeing the Father communicating with the Son, and they get confused, and they see this relationship, and right away they think we have to have another God person. I'm sorry, Socinians really don't believe that. Arianism and Trinitarianism begins to see a distinction, and they say, well, see, that's another person. That's another identity as an angel or as another true God person. But there's only one true God, the Father, who came to save us by becoming a genuine man. And that scripture, the scriptures prove that Jesus is that true identity when he said before Abraham was, I am. God bless.
I want to thank the viewers out there for being with us. This was the conclusion of a four-hour debate. So if you didn't hear the other 3 hours, we'll go back and find those other episodes, part 1, 2, 3, and of course this is 4, to see what you missed. It was a good exchange, a lot of theological information, a lot of church history. I think it would be a good benefit for you. I want to throw in my 2 cents worth here as I close this debate in this program here. I want to call attention to people at home to check out Hebrews chapter 7, verse 3. Without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abideth the priest continually. So remember what I always say at the end of these shows, John 14:6. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father except by me. Believe on him if you want to have eternal life. All right, with that, I'm Larry Wessels, the moderator for this debate and also director of Christian Answers, and I want to thank you for joining us and be with us again for another edition of Christian Answers Presents. God bless you all.
Please contact Christian Answers for free information on numerous subjects, important subjects such as the biblical doctrine of the Godhead, the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Free newsletters are available on the heretical position held by many unbiblical cults, such as Jehovah's Witnesses and the Oneness Pentecostals who deny the Trinity. Free newsletters are available on strange groups such as the King James Onlyites. To receive your free information, please call 512-218-8022 or email us at cdebater@aol.com.
Hello, this is Larry Wessels, Director of Christian Answers of Austin, Texas, Christian Debater, and I'd like to let you know that free newsletters are available from our ministry. Just email us at cdebater@aol.com and give us your mailing address and we'll mail them out to you for free. You can also call us at 512-218-8022 and leave your address there. You can also access all our newsletters online by going to one of our three websites called BibleQuery.org. Once on the homepage, simply click on the experience box and then scroll down to the newsletter section as shown here. Since our number one most watched video of the over 548 videos we have produced for YouTube at the time of this recording is Unpopular Bible Doctrines number one, The Biblical God No One Wants to Know, with over 433,000 viewings, our latest newsletter is called Unpopular Topic, How Sovereign is God? Our second most viewed YouTube video is 6-year-old wife of Muhammad was okay by the Muslim God Allah, but not by the biblical God of Jesus, with over 341,000 viewings. We also have three newsletters available on Islam. Our video, Debate, Larry Wessels versus Two Jehovah's Witnesses at a University Study Center, currently has close to 150,000 views. See our newsletter on the Jehovah's Witnesses, Jehovah's Witnesses, Deceived Deceivers. Our video, Is Jesus God Almighty in the Flesh, meaning the second person of the Trinity, or is he something else, has over 101,000 viewings. See our newsletter, Testimony to the Eternal Godhead, the Trinity. Our video, Biography, the famous 19th century Prince of Preachers, Charles Haddon Spurgeon, a man of God, has close to 89,000 views. See two of our newsletters with lead articles from sermons by Spurgeon. Our video, UFOs, Ancient Aliens, or Beings of the Fourth Dimension, number one, Fact or Fiction, has over 207,000 viewings. Not only do UFOs and the occult use the same disciplines, such as levitation, teleportation of objects, psychokinesis, clairvoyance, automatic writing, and telepathy, but their theologies are completely foreign to biblical Christianity. UFO theologies include everything from reincarnation and evolution to man achieving cosmic godhood, but they do not include Jesus Christ as the only mediator between God and man, 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. We have two newsletters related to the world of the occult to which UFOs are a part. Our video, Former Roman Catholic Bride of Christ Nun Testifies of Abnormal Life in the Convent, has over 67,000 viewings. Our video featuring former Roman Catholic Rob Zins, who has a Master of Theology from Dallas Theological Seminary, Historical Split Between Roman Catholicism and the Christ of the Scripture, Man's Word or God's Word, has over 53,000 viewings. See our two newsletters on the subject of Roman Catholicism. Our video, Cult of Ellen G. White, number one, Beginnings of the 19th Century Religion, called Seventh-day Adventism, has over 48,000 viewings and features former Seventh-day Adventist Wallace Slattery, who has 44 years' experience with this religion. Our playlist, called Dealing with Seventh-day Adventism and Their Prophetess, features 15 videos with 14 hours of material. See our newsletter, Seventh-day Adventism, True or False? For theological music lovers, see our video, Favorite Old-Time Christian Bluegrass Gospel Music, Psalm 98, verses 4 and 5. With over 214,000 viewings. We have also posted several music videos by my own daughter, Marlena Wessels from her CD, Win This Fight, songs she has written and performed herself. To see our music videos, please go to our main YouTube channel page. Scroll down to our multiple playlists. Arrow over to our playlist called Our Radio Shows with National Christian Authors and Music Vids. Once there, scroll down to the bottom of the playlist where the music videos are listed. I could go on and on, but this should be sufficient for now. Don't forget to check out our main YouTube channel, See Answers TV, which stands for Christian Answers Television, also which has over 19 playlists by topic as you scroll down our channel page.